The first step in performing a MIMO-FRF test is to open your General Test Lab folder, double-click on the Structures Acquisition folder, and double-click on the MIMO-FRF testing application. Now, while that opens, let's take a closer look at our setup. Let's talk a little bit about our test setup. First, we have our Jungle Gym here, which we're using to support our test object, which is this clear plexiglass plate, which is suspended by two bungee cords that we're using to simulate a free-free test condition. Additionally, we have two measurement locations, measurement location number one and measurement location number two. At each measurement location, we have a shaker, shaker number one and shaker number two. And when we focus in on shaker number one for a moment, we can see at the end of the stinger, we have an impedance head, not a force cell. What's the difference? Well, quite simply, as you see these two wires here, an impedance head measures not only the force from the shaker into the structure, but also the acceleration at this location, which becomes quite convenient when we need to look at driving point measurements. As well, we have an identical setup at measurement location number two. We have a second impedance head measuring the force from the shaker into the structure at this location, as well as the acceleration at this location. And finally, we have here our data acquisition system, which in this case is a Siemens SCADIS Mobile 1 slot. And when we look at the front panel of our data acquisition system, we see that there are four LED lights on here, representing the four channels that we're measuring. Because remember, at measurement location number one, we're measuring force and acceleration with our impedance head. And at measurement location number two, we're also measuring force as well as acceleration. So that's four channels. And lastly, we have here our source outputs. We have two independent sources, one going to shaker number one and a second going to shaker number two. Now it's very important that we have independent sources, because if we were to take the same signal and tee it between two shakers, then our sources would not be uncorrelated and we could not do MIMO-FRF testing. Now that the software is opened up, let's take a quick look at the channel setup page. You'll notice that we've turned on the first four inputs for measuring the acceleration and force at our two measurement locations. As well, note we have two references, one for the shaker input at point one and a second for the shaker input at point two. Additionally, you want to make note that you have the correct point names. If you're going to be using these FRFs later to animate mode shapes, it will need to match exactly the names on your geometry. As well, other things you need to specify on the channel setup page, the appropriate directions, the input modes, as well as the sensitivities. Now using the lower tab menu, we'll select MIMO-FRF setup. We'll use this tab to set up the parameters of our MIMO-FRF test. As you'll see in this upper box, the online data function, this is where you select the functions that you will measure and save. For our example, we'll simply be interested in saving the auto power information as well as the FRFs, and that would include as well the coherence. Using source parameters, we can select the signal type that we'll be using for our MIMO test. As you can see, MIMO-FRF testing application has many different choices, but we'll simply just choose continuous random. You'll note that you need to choose it for output one and output two. We'll select a voltage range. We'll just use 0.1 volts. You can select a frequency definition. This is the frequency range over which we will focus all the energy from our shaker. This is our frequency range of interest. So we will just use 100 to 1000. And you choose the noise type. In this case, we'll just go with white noise. Using the box menu to the far right, we can select all of our acquisition parameters for our FRFs, that being our bandwidth, the spectral lines, and we'll see the resulting resolution, as well as we can select a number of averages and any type of windowing. For this example, let's just use uniform. Now that all our parameters are set, we're ready to move ahead to our MIMO-FRF measurement tab and start the test. We select arm, wait for the system to initialize, and then press start. Here we can see our continuous random time history signal for measurement point 1 and 2, as well as an FRF from those two locations. We can see that we're steady building in our averages. It's going to keep taking data till we get to 40. So we've now achieved our 40 averages and we have our FRF. Now, if you look at it, it did smooth out more and more as we got more averages. But even at 40 averages, you can still see that the FRF isn't quite that smooth for any of these modes. Now, what's the issue then? Well, if we go back to our MIMO FRF setup, you'll see we chose a continuous random signal type. And for conditioning, we went with the uniform window, which basically means no window. So basically our FRF is suffering from leakage because we don't have a periodic signal. Now, what we could do is simply use a Hanning window on our reference and response, and that would improve our FRF, make it more smooth. But another option is to make the signal itself periodic. And how we can do that is using burst random. So we'll change both output 1 and output 2 signal types to burst random. We'll change our mode to burst, and we'll keep the windows at uniform. And we'll increase our level here to match our past measurement of 0.2 volts. And go back to measure. Arm the system. Hit start. Now right off the bat, we can see that our FRFs are much smoother because we have a periodic signal. It's zero at the beginning and it's zero at the end because the signal actually turns off. So let's take 40 averages and compare. So now we have our 40 averages and we look at our FRF now, and it is certainly much smoother at each mode in comparison to our continuous random that didn't have a window. So those are some of the basic steps to performing your first MIMO FRF test. Lastly, I'd like to briefly discuss an important quality check we should perform related to our shaker inputs. As we already stated, in a proper MIMO modal test setup, all the shaker input forces need to be uncorrelated. Additionally, the responses need to be completely caused by the measured input forces. Unfortunately, there's a function available in SimCenter Test Lab to perform this important quality check on our test setup. It's called Principal Component Analysis, or the acronym is PCA. Principal Component Analysis determines how many uncorrelated signals there are and if there are other unknown forces acting on the system. To enable this function, we simply need to go back to our MIMO FRF Setup tab. Then we'll go to the online data function area, and we'll go all the way to the end to PCA. And we're going to select PCA on references and one response. And here we want to go measure and save. And this option will allow us to determine the degree of decorrelation between our two shaker inputs and if there are any other unknown forces acting on the system. And you'll notice once you turn on this option, you now have the ability to choose which of your response channels you will use in the PCA calculation. We're going to use input 1. Now we'll just go back to our MIMO FRF measurement tab. And we're going to take another measurement with this function turned on. And after we do our 40 averages, we're going to look at the principal component analysis results. So we'll arm our system. Hit start. Here we are 40 averages later, And we can actually look at the results of our principal component analysis right here on the MIMO FRF measurement tab. Simply go to responses, instead of FRF, we'll select PCA. So what do we have here? We have a display for principal component number one, a display for principal component number two, and a display for principal component number three. Now, what will we expect to see from our principal component analysis? Well, we know we have two shakers, both with independent uncorrelated sources, and no other forces acting on our system. When we look at the principal component analysis results, when we see higher values for the principal component, that represents an independent source. So we have two independent sources, and when we look at principal component number three, we see that the values are very low in comparison. So that helps us see that there are no other outside forces acting on the system. Now that we've verified that our setup is good using principal component analysis, let me show you an example of how principal component analysis can help us determine if we have a problem with the shaker. I'm going to disconnect one of the sources from our front end to one of our shakers, and we're going to rerun our test and review the principal component analysis afterwards. So we'll arm again, and we'll start, and we're going to measure 40 averages. Well, looking at these FRF results, right away you can see these aren't the cleanest FRFs we could possibly have. And maybe you can convince yourself they're not that bad. I don't think you can convince me of that. Maybe you would even think that you just have a leakage issue. But in reality, it's a totally different problem, right? What happens when we look at the PCA? So what would we expect to see with our current setup? We know we disconnected the source to one of the shakers. However, we know the other shaker is still working, and we will measure force as well as acceleration at both point one and point two. However, that will all be to force from one shaker. And that's exactly what we see here in our PCA. We only have one principal component with high values in comparison to the others. Principal component two and three are all very low. So this is how you can use principal component analysis to verify that all your shakers are working in your MIMO modal test. Finally, I'd like to demonstrate how we can use PCA, principal component analysis, to identify unknown sources in our test setup. Now we've reconnected the shaker, so both are working now. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a measurement, and at the same time, I'm going to use this pointer here to tap on our plate. This will be our unknown source. And let's see what our PCA shows us after the measurement. So we'll arm, and hit start. Okay, so I stopped tapping a little bit early. Didn't want to do that for 40 averages. Nonetheless, I think we can see the result already in our PCA. When we look at our principal component analysis, we see not just one and two sources as we would expect, one from each of our shakers, but we also see a third principal component. You might recall this was so low that you couldn't even see the values previously. But because now I was, with my tapping, adding an unmeasured source, PCA helps us to determine that we have an unmeasured source in our setup that we need to account for. Well, that was a basic overview of how to perform a MIMO FRF test, as well as a principal component analysis to check the quality of your setup. Hope you enjoyed the video.